Did sing that song. Let's give it up for the DeKalb County Choir. Thank you very much for being the voice of DeKalb County. And of course, to the members of the band, the talented musicians. I understand some of you are also DeKalb County employees and residents. So thank you for your contributions and setting the tone for this beautiful occasion. Good morning and welcome to your 32nd annual Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King celebration. I will formally introduce myself in just a moment, but we do want to start this occasion the proper way. Please let us stand for the presentation of colors as well as the Pledge of Allegiance.
term. Art. Detail. Ho! Raise head. Ho!
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Carry on. You may be seated. We have to thank the DeKalb County Police Honor Guard for their presentation of colors, as well as all of DeKalb County Police and firefighters and the first responders who work so hard to keep our county safe. Thank you. And now we are set to begin the event that celebrates the life and legacy of one of the greatest civil servants and leaders in history, the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. This is such a special occasion everywhere, every time this happens, and I think it is so important that all of us take a moment to acknowledge the beloved community that Dr. King spoke of, planted that seed for, and made sure that we continue to teach that to our children, but sometimes the adults need a reminder of what that beloved community is all about, and I'm so honored to be here in the county that I call home to celebrate this day with you. My name is Portia Bruner. I'm a reporter at Fox 5 News. Thank you from the choir. I work in DeKalb County. The station is located on Briarcliff Road near Emory University and the CDC. I live in DeKalb County. I remember driving into DeKalb County on December 2nd, 2002, coming in from South Carolina onto I-20 and into DeKalb County, and I knew that my marker was Stonecrest Mall, that meant that I was getting close to where I was supposed to be. I had just come from Virginia, where I was a consumer reporter, and I was really excited to come to Atlanta and get a job and be a journalist in Atlanta. And so it means a lot to me to work in DeKalb, to live in DeKalb. I have two sons who are in DeKalb County Schools, a private school and a public school. I vote in DeKalb. I go to church in DeKalb. I go to the gym in DeKalb. I am so DeKalb. I even have one of those little tank tops that say Decatur, where it's greater. Even though I know Incorporated Decatur doesn't even run through I-20. And it's so old, it's faded, and I need to go back to that little shop on Wesley Chapel and get a new one. I love DeKalb County. And I have a vested interest in the future of DeKalb County because I plan to make DeKalb County home for a long time. As a reporter, it is my job to fairly and accurately and in a balanced way cover all of DeKalb County, and I try to do that every time I'm assigned to a story in my county. So know that when I am doing a story, whether it is good, whether it is bad, I am doing the best I can to fairly tell what is happening in this county. That being said, I will be your mistress of ceremonies for our program today. And to kick things off, I'd like to invite our presiding officer of the DeKalb County Board of Commissioners, Commissioner Larry Johnson, to join us for a formal welcome.
All right. Portia says she works in DeKalb and I walk in DeKalb. I step in DeKalb, and I love DeKalb. Good morning, everybody. And welcome to our Martin Luther King celebration. This is a great celebration. We celebrate the life of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King. And thank you for being a part of this program. What I'm so excited about this program, you had a chance to see our great employee choir. This choir is made up of employees throughout DeKalb County departments. And employees put together this whole program with volunteers and retirees. So let's give them a hand, everybody. And it's so important during the welcome that I talk about the African proverb that says, we make the path by walking it together. Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King was the one who walked the path, and he wants us to walk that same path of peace, of love, how we make things happen here, not only in DeKalb, but in the state of Georgia and throughout this nation. So as we celebrate this program today, make sure that we understand that it's not a day off, but a day on. That we understand that it's all about us being our brother's keeper and how we get together in our neighborhoods and focus on violence prevention and peace throughout. A lot of folks saying, what can we do about all the violence in our community? It's all about L-O-V-E. Love conquers all. It's not touchy, fretful, or resentful. It makes things happen. It makes things go forward. And if we all can continue to be that way and move towards that, we can make things happen in our community. That's why I'm excited to celebrate the 32nd anniversary that we're here to do today. And it's appropriately named, from civil rights to human rights, our courage to lead. And that's what it takes today, folks. We have to have courage. Courage to lead from every aspects of life. And Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King stood for that. He fought for that. And he died for that. And I'd like to thank also again our employees who made this happen. And I'm just so proud of them because they do it every year. They get together, they practice. Our great choir is going to sing us to heaven. Our Holy Ghost posse over here going to play the music, going to make it happen for us. And I want to thank Portia Bruner from Fox 5 for participating on this program. I had a chance to meet her a couple of years ago, and she's always had a fair and balanced approach to about DeKalb, and she's doing a great job. Let's give her a hand, our mistress of ceremony. And I'm also excited about our keynote speaker. I want y'all to point to him and say, bring it, preacher.
Bring it.
Y'all give him a hand, Pastor Marlon D. Harris. And I welcome our TV audience and all the folks who are participating here today. Let's have fun. Let's enjoy it. Let's make sure that we continue to make Dr. Martin Luther King proud, because he wants us to be moving forward. He wants us to be unified. He wants us to have the best out of life. He wants our communities to be strong. And so we can all do that together by saying we love each other and make things happen. So welcome on behalf of Commissioner Johnson, the Board of Commissioners, and our interim CEO, Lee May. Thank you all for participating today.
Thank you, Commissioner Johnson. Next, I'd like to ask Chaplain Christine Lawrence to lead her in a moment of prayer and reflection.
Good morning, DeKalb. It's a great day in DeKalb County. Can we give the Spirit of God and love a hand clap of praise in this place? It is a great day to celebrate the life of Dr. Martin Luther King. Let us bow our heads in a word of prayer. Oh, gracious Father, the one who brings us and wakes us up this morning, the one who's put food on our table, we praise you this day, oh God. Father, we ask you, as we come before you and invite your presence in this place, that the same spirit that resided in your servant, Dr. Martin Luther King, would reside in us. Let us be a day of reflection, not just of his life, but of our life, oh God. Let us reflect and not learn to just tolerate, but we would celebrate all of those that come in contact with us this day, oh God. So, Lord, we praise you, and we are excited for the agenda this day. Take hold of this place, oh God. We praise you. In the name above all names, we pray. Amen and amen.
I would be remiss. I forgot, because of this cold that Zach Williams gave me last week, I couldn't say it. But I want to have all of our elected officials to please stand. And let's give them a round of applause. Please, all of our elected officials, please stand. Thank them for their service. And thank them for coming as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner, and thank you for that powerful, powerful prayer. There's nothing like good music and a good word to start a good day. Now let us welcome our DeKalb County Choir employee choir back to the front and center to get us really in the spirit. Let's give them another round of applause.
This is not the time to question your faith. This is not the place where you should be. No, no, no. It's not the time nor the place to throw in the towel. You gotta hold on. You gotta be strong. This is not the time to question your faith. This is not your place where you should be. No, it isn't, no, no. It's not the time nor the place to throw in the towel. You gotta hold on. You gotta be strong. Sometimes you win, sometimes you lose. It's a part of life everyone goes through. Sometimes it's joy, sometimes there's pain. It's a part of God's plan, so don't be dismayed. This is not the time. The second verse. This is not the time to question your faith. This is not the place where you should be. No, it isn't, no, no. It's not the time nor the place to throw in the towel. You gotta press on. You gotta move on. Sometimes you win. A part of life that everyone goes through. Sometimes it's joy, sometimes there's pain. It's a part of God's plan, so don't be dismayed. This is not the time. Oh yeah, you gotta learn. This part right here. There's still hope for the hopeless.
There's still hope for the hopeless.
There's still life for the lifeless.
There is life for the lifeless.
God is a friend to the friendless.
He's a friend to the friendless.
He'll give you peace and sweet rest.
Peace.
Let me just say for the record, with the cameras rolling, I have covered I don't know how many commission meetings in this room, and I forgot that we were in the place where I'm usually taking notes and trying to tweet. And what did he say? Oh, he said, oh, what is she? Oh, I forgot that's where we were. Thank you for taking us to the next level, which is further proof that God is always present. I know we're in the county government building, but I will just say thank you. And I'm not sure which departments you work in, but if I ever happen to be doing business, like at the clerk's office where we're getting the passports, please just start singing that. Just sing. Oh my gosh, what a gift and an anointment. Thank you so much. Well, next, a talented young man who really needs no introduction, an inspirational speaker and poet, and recently performed for First Lady Michelle Obama. Please give a warm welcome for Mr. Hank Stewart.
Wow, I need to talk to whoever put me on program. Because that is so unfair. Oh my goodness, it is so unfair. Wow. You know, Dr. King said, if you want to be important, wonderful. If you want to be great, wonderful. If you want to be recognized, wonderful. But recognize he or she who's greatest among you shall be a servant. That's the new definition of greatness. And by giving that definition of greatness, it means everyone can be great because everyone can serve. You don't have to have a college degree to serve. You don't have to make your subject and verbs agree to serve. You don't have to know Plato or Aristotle to serve, or Einstein theory of relativity, or the second theory of thermodynamics and physics to serve. You only need a heart full of grace, a soul generated by love, and you too can be that servant. That's one of Dr. King's quotes, one of my favorite quotes. You know, Dr. King was always mad. A lot of y'all didn't know that, right? He was always mad. M-A-D. He was always making a difference. Always making a difference. And so the poem I'm going to do for you is a piece that's entitled, Who Am I? Let me tell you who I am. Now, some of you will want to know, and others listen very closely, because at the end of this poem, there might be an exam. But I'm the one who made your life what it is today. It's because of me on playgrounds, your offsprings and little white kids play. Let me tell you who I am. I'm the one that tree branch didn't get. I'm the one that noose was made for and God said it doesn't fit. Let me tell you who I am. I'm the one that bullet missed, the one that jail cell couldn't break. I'm the one who was denied education because of hate. Oh, let me tell you who I am. I'm the one who couldn't sit on the front seat of that bus but get down on the front line in the war for Uncle Sam. It's not always about you. Don't be so full of yourself. It's because of me you can enjoy public accommodations and there's no roof or ceiling on your income or wealth. Let me tell you who I am. You should be thinking about me in your every move. You see, I'm the slave that the slave masters beat because I wouldn't follow the rules. I'm that poet who dropped rhythm and rhymes. I'm that civil rights leader who was struck down in their prime. I'm that songstress who could only sing about pain. I'm that color they say, now boy, you stay in your lane. I'm that dancer they say you would never dance on, you would never dance for our troop. I'm that athlete they said, I'm that musician they said, we don't want to hear from you. You can't perform. We don't want to hear from your group. I'm that athlete they said you would never play on this field. I'm that doctor that say I die before I let you touch me and say that I was healed. Who am I? I'm the carpenter, the teacher, the pilot who flies the plane. I'm the one who went through all of that so you can be all that you can be. Let me make it plain. And now you have the audacity not to speak to each other like you did it on your own and there's no one you owe. Who am I? I'm your ancestors, but the shame is you don't know who I am. If you never come face to face with the devil, you and him must be heading in the same direction.
Thank you. Thank you for that powerful word and for being the voice of our ancestors. It is now my pleasure to introduce Interim CEO Lee May. Lee May was appointed Interim Chief Executive Officer of DeKalb County by Governor Nathan Deal in July of 2013 to run the day-to-day operation of Georgia's third largest county and administer the county's $1.2 billion annual budget. As the youngest person ever to serve as CEO, Lee May has promoted progress and movement through cultivating collaboration with the stakeholders across the county. Immediately prior to his appointment as interim CEO, May served as the presiding officer of the Board of Commissioners and chairman of the Budget and Finance Committee. Voters first chose May in July of 2006 in a special election to fill the seat vacated by then Commissioner Congressman Hank Johnson, and was subsequently reelected twice by an overwhelming majority. Please welcome Interim CEO Lee May.
Well, good afternoon. You all look marvelous. Let's give it up again for the DeKalb County Gospel Choir and the band. You know, I walked in and I asked them, were they ready for my solo? And they resoundingly said no. I said, you don't want me to be great, but that's okay. We got next year, right? Let's give it up for Portia Bruner again. I told her we're going to take her on the road. She's our marketing director for DeKalb County. And for Hank Stewart, my friend, who is a phenomenal DeKalb County resident as well. You know, he loves and talks greatly about DeKalb County. And, you know, it's always hard. I never, ever, ever, ever want to follow him talking because the way that he puts words together, you know, and never has a piece of paper. And he walks up, but he walks away with power. Your mouth is wide open in awe of the words that he said. And he always has a message behind the words that he has. It's not just feel-good stuff. It's a message of making a difference in people's lives. So thank you, Hank, for the work that you do. So again, y'all, we are so happy that you all are here today honoring the 32nd annual Martin Luther King celebration. And it's something that we do each and every year in DeKalb County because we don't want to forget who Dr. King really was to us here in DeKalb, in our state, in our nation, and in our world. And the work that he has done is something that we have to remember each and every day. The theme is civil rights to human rights, the courage to lead. He has a quote that I love to repeat, and that he says that the measure of a man is not where he stands, and I always add, or she, in times of comfort and convenience, but it's where they stand in times of conflict and controversy. That's the measure of a man. It's not when things are easy, it's when things are tough. When you're up against the ropes, when everything says that you are going to fail, that's the measure of who you truly are. And we can't forget that. You think about what Dr. King had to deal with. You know, he would have been 87 years of age today. 87. And his life was cut short by a bullet that wanted to take his voice from him. But y'all know we couldn't take away his voice. His voice continues to talk about that dream that he had, that he said that one day this nation will rise up and live out the true meaning of its creed, that all men, and it's funny, even in the language that he gave back then, that left out women, but all men and all women would live out its creed, and that all men and women are created equal. So we can't forget that. And that's what today is about. We have to remember what he preached, what he taught us, and we got to live it out. The elected officials have been acknowledged here today, and just wave your hand again. All elected officials, they're up here in the front two rows. They are here to serve, but we are all trying to live out his dream, you know, and making our county, making our nation a better place. You know, he was arrested 30 times. One time was here. I guess we were made famous here in DeKalb County. He had to go and sit in our jail. We got our sheriff here, Jeff Mann.
He had to sit in the jail that, it wasn't that jail, but in the jail that we had here in DeKalb County over a traffic incident. He arrested that man for something that he probably didn't even do. But he stayed in our jail here. That was over 49 years ago that he came through our county. And so, you know, he also had a saying that darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. Hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that. Our presiding officer talked about love, and we all have to exude that love, because it's only love that's going to move us and move this county forward. So, you know, I think about what he's meant. I've had the honor and pleasure of meeting his family. His wife, before she passed, had an honor of being at her funeral with all the leaders, seemed like, of this nation, and good friends with his daughter, Bernice. And, you know, just the legacy that he has left for us, we cannot forget that legacy. And I'm honored to be in a position that I'm in because of the work that he did, the work that he called us all to do together. And I think about my father. My father, during that time in the late 60s, you know, when they were fighting segregation and we were giving, as African Americans and people of color, various privileges that people hadn't had before. My father helped to integrate Northeast Louisiana State, and some of you all may have heard me state this, but they integrated the school. He was in the second class of African Americans. They integrated the school, but they didn't integrate the bus system. He was born in Delhi, Louisiana, right off I-20. If you ever go down I-20 going west, you'll see it's one exit, not two, one exit. He had to hitchhike 20 miles every day to go to Northeast Louisiana State in Monroe, Louisiana. He integrated the dorms there. He was the first African-American to live in the dorms there. That's my father. My father. He's 60-something. That wasn't that long ago, you all. And so we have to remember the struggles, the fights that we still have so far to go. Although we've come so far, we have, the fight is still real. Not only here in DeKalb, but in our nation and in our world. And we have to continue to honor this great man, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. So let me move on now and honor and acknowledge and tell you about who our guest speaker is here today, Pastor Marlon Harris. It's a pleasure and honor to have him here today with us. He is the pastor of New Life Church in Decatur, where it's greater. And he has done, let me tell you, if you don't know this man, he has done a phenomenal job. He's the founder of this church that was founded in 1995. So for 20 years, he's been doing phenomenal work here in Decatur. Now here's the thing, he's a graduate of one of the best educational institutions on the planet, the Clark Atlanta University. Though I sound a little biased, can y'all guess where I went for undergrad? I went to Clark Atlanta for undergrad and for Emory, the second best, or the equal best, or I'm getting myself in trouble, right? But he's a graduate of Clark Atlanta University. New Life has served as a leading ministry presence in the metro Atlanta area for the past 20 years. He received the call to preach the gospel at the age of 9 years old. And he was ordained at the age of 12. Now think about what you were doing at 9. And Lord knows you weren't being ordained at 12. So Pastor Harris has invested in DeKalb County. He founded the first full-service community center located in South DeKalb County. If you were to travel down Candler Road, and you will see the phenomenal work on taking, if I believe that was the old Southwest DeKalb High School. That church bought the entire property, and it's a tremendous thing that they've been doing along that corridor in Decatur. He launched Community Impact Week, a spirit-filled event that ministers to the community through haircuts, meals, clothing, and health services. Now that's ministry, you all. That's in the legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King. In 2002, New Life Community Ministries was established as a community development corporation of New Life Church and has become a beacon of hope to the South DeKalb community. Since then, he launched Clean Up DeKalb, a homeless and drug rehab outreach service, Project SOAR, a program which ministers to first-time juvenile offenders and their families, and many others. So it's an honor to introduce to you today a servant leader who is whose boots are on the ground right here in DeKalb County. Every day he builds up the foundation of civil rights established by our great leader, Dr. Martin Luther King, through his courage and through his leadership. So ladies and gentlemen, we are going to bring up again the best choir. I won't get in trouble for that. The best choir, not only in DeKalb County, but we got to get them a record deal, right? We can add that on to your salaries, right? I don't know, as our county attorney here, that may not be legal, but we're going to bring up, again, our DeKalb County choir, and then after they finish singing, the next words that you will hear will be from Reverend Marlon Harris, the pastor of New Life Church.
Thank you. I believe we need to turn this auditorium into a sanctuary and give God praise for making a way. Out of no way, He made a way. In the midst of our struggles, in the midst of our pain, in the midst of our trials and tribulations, He made a way for us. He made a way for us collectively. From slavery until now, He's made a way for us. He's made a way for us individually. You know where you come from. You know where you're going. You know what God brought you out of. Our God made a way. Give Him praise. Give Him glory. Father, it is in moments like these that we admit that we need You afresh. We cannot survive without You. That You are our hope and our strength. Upon You we depend. Thank You for the spirit and the legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King. Thank You, God, for what He has secured, as well as those who were freedom fighters on the forefronts of the civil rights movement, for what they have secured for us a generation or two generations past. Father, we give You praise that we no longer sit on designated seats on public buses. We thank You that we can eat and dine in the main cabin of any restaurant we choose. We give You praise that we're able to matriculate and graduate from colleges as prestigious as Harvard or as simple as the local high school. Thank You, God, that we are not characterized or we are stigmatized by the color of our skin, but rather we are judged by the contents of our character. Thank You, God, for this opportunity that You've given us to not just be free, but to live in the freedom that You have given to us. Thank You for those warriors who fought on the battlefield, who went to jail for us, who were hosed down by fire hoses for us, beaten and whipped for us, chased down by dogs for us, had lashes placed on their backs by slave masters for us. Thank You, God, for Your faithfulness to us. Now we stand here because You are a good God. We stand in this place because You have brought us over. You brought us through. We give Your name praise. May the words that we say today, may they not only reflect the spirit of the season and age in which we're in, but may they allow us to look toward You for a greater hope. May they allow us to look toward You for greater strength. May You be our foundation. It is in the precious name of Jesus we pray. And the people of God said, amen, amen. And amen again. Amen. It is good to be here. I am absolutely honored to be standing here before you in this August and amazing celebration of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s life and legacy. I want to give my thanks and appreciation to our interim CEO, who very ably and capably leads our county and provides leadership for us to make our lives better. Would you help me say thanks to Commissioner Lee May, CEO Lee May. I'm grateful to God for the welcome that we received from my commissioner, Commissioner Larry Johnson, who does a fine and amazing job in the district that he serves, and we all felt welcome because of his words that he brought to us. And of course, our MC, Sister Portia, thank you so much for being a part of this experience and program and guiding us through this program. All of our elected officials, you've already stood, but we thank you for your leadership. We thank you for the tireless effort and service and work that you do every single day. Stan Watson and, of course, our sheriff, Jeff Mann, thank you all, so many of you, for the work and the effort that you do. What can I say about Hank Stewart? My Lord. I was happy that I was invited until I looked at the program and I saw Hank was on the program. And I said, they must want me to do poem and he to do the speaking, because he is a powerhouse of motivation, inspiration, and information. And we thank God for you. Bless you, Hank. Bless you so much. This choir has done a phenomenal job lifting our spirits and reminding us of the grace and hope that we have. Come on and thank God for this amazing DeKalb County Choir. Amen. 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 I am honored to have my wife here with me this morning, Sister Monica Harris. I'm so glad to have her in our midst. Stand up so that we may be able to see you. Give her a hand. Give her a hand. She is a source of strength and friendship for me in so many ways in my leadership and ministry. And my mother is here as well. She's sitting on the front row. I'm so glad to have my mom here to be with us today. My sister-in-law is here as well, Sister Tanya Harris. I know you don't want to stand up, but stand up anyway. Stand up anyway. She's here representing my brother because he isn't here. Amen. Representing him. All of the members of our church, of New Life Church, I am overwhelmed by your presence. Wave your hand at me. Thank you so much for being here. Thank you so much for being here. Before we get into our discussion, I need to make a confession and I need to confess something. Commissioner, CEO May, all of those anonymous emails that you got, about 50 or 75 of them, they were from me, sir, inviting you to encourage you to have Pastor Harris come and speak. I have to admit, I sent all of those anonymous emails to him. I started early on in the year, said, why not invite Marlon Harris to come and speak for the Martin Luther King Jr. celebration? And put up signs all around the county, please, CEO May, invite Marlon Harris to come and speak. Subliminally, it got a hold of him, and here's where I am today. I am known for being long-winded. My church is used to that, but I will not torture you with my idiosyncrasies this morning. To make sure that I would not go over my time, because I was given a very strict time limit, to make sure I don't go over my time, I parked right in front of the building on the street and only paid for an hour. So it's almost time for me to go back and get my car. But we have something to share in the time that we'll spend together this morning. We celebrate and experience the reality of our freedom and liberation today, standing on the shoulders of Dr. Martin Luther King. And we're peering at our world and looking at our lives and our nation through the eyes of his amazing and prophetic dream that Dr. King spoke about today before today was ever possible. It's a dream that saw beyond the conditions of his commonplace circumstances. And he dreamed of a world where we would be able to do exactly what we're doing right now. Blacks and whites, Jews and Gentiles, Protestant and Catholic, sitting together in one common unity for one common purpose. Only a prophet can see into the future. And Dr. King was a prophet to our nation. And it is only right that now when you step on our nation's mall in Washington, D.C., you'll see the various prophets and sages and leaders of our country. And you'll see men like Thomas Jefferson, and you'll see men like Abraham Lincoln. Men who understood freedom but did not understand its full ramifications for all Americans who were of different shades of color and different ethnicities. And Thomas Jefferson, who is so poignant in the contributions he's given to us in our Declaration of Independence. However, he was a slave owner himself. And so he wrote about being free, but he did not know enough to practice that freedom with his individual value. But you'll see Thomas Jefferson's statue, and almost over against his statue, you'll see the figure of a man with his arms folded much like this, almost as if he's saying to Thomas Jefferson that I am the embodiment of the liberty that you wrote about in our Declaration of Independence. And so this morning, I want to honor the theme that has been given to me for our discussion with you this morning and talk with you from the thought, from civil rights to human rights, the courage to lead. from civil rights to human rights, the courage to lead. No one can deny the obvious connection between our civil rights and our human rights. To deny a person either of these is to denigrate him or her in the status of being non-human or not a citizen. As I prepared for this worship experience, I found myself involved in a philosophical struggle in my mind and in my heart that, in an effort to separate civil rights from human rights, I found myself unable to do so. Civil rights is an idea that's rooted in the concepts of equity and fairness. And human rights is an idea that's rooted in the concepts of love, honor, and dignity. And at a foundational, fundamental level, one idea that's human rights, it demands the existence of the other idea, and that is civil rights. Without both human rights and civil rights, a person ceases to be a person. Julian Bond was right when he accented this whole issue of human rights when he said the humanity of all Americans is diminished when any group is denied the human rights that is granted to any other group. And no less right was Elie Wiesel whenever he surveyed the horrors of the Holocaust and survived those horrors himself as one who was starved and emaciated in the concentration camps. He said, wherever men and women are persecuted because of their race, their religion, or their political views, that place must at that moment become the center of the universe. And Elie Wiesel, he said, because human rights can never be replaced with personal preferences. When our prejudices, and all of us have them, but when our prejudices stop us from extending the basic rights of life, liberty, and happiness to those that are around us or those who are in our social construct, we have allowed our preference to trump civil rights and basic human rights, and that makes us non-human and immoral. It is an evil society that forgets that all of us may be of different colors of our skin, but we all have the same color of blood that runs through our veins, and we're all members of the same human race. And human rights are the living rights that are basic to all human beings. These are the most fundamental rights given to mankind. They include the right to life, the right to education, the right to protection from torture, the right of a free and a harmless expression, the right to be liberated and owned by no man. Civil rights, on the other hand, arises only out of a virtue of legal grant, such as the rights imparted in the American Constitution. There is no other country where you get a document as wonderfully written and as well spoken as our very own Constitution. And even yet more impressive and reasonable is our Declaration of Independence. It states, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, and that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. However, though those words are poetic and though those words are profound, we know that in the grim reality of the African American lives that were brought to this country, they were categorically and systematically denied those basic human rights and civil rights, and it was not even a discussion if they would be considered a citizen of our country. We know that you can write it on paper, but until it gets lived out in the fabric of our everyday existence in our country, it is not a reality for anyone if it is not a reality for everyone. We saw in this country, in this nation, not for a few years, not for several years,
We saw for over 250 years, and many would even say before the nation became a nation, for 400 years, ever since the 1600s, we saw the enslavement of African people from Africa, enslaved to work in cotton fields and tobacco fields and soybean fields, to labor on plantations that they could never own, nor even sit at a table to eat a meal that they even prepared. We saw it in our country for 400 years, longer than the country has been a country. Slavery in our country, it's a blight on our nation. It is a blight in our world, a blight in our social conscience of our country. However, today, after civil rights, today in the 21st century, today after the marches on Washington, today after marching in Selma, after marching in Birmingham, today after integration and segregation has been annihilated, even today we're still racially profiled. Even today, we still struggle to get the same opportunities. Even today, a Trayvon Martin can be shot down just because he's walking home. We've come a long way, but we have a long way left to go. We've crossed some great rivers, but we still have some mighty rivers we have yet to cross. We talk about human rights. There was an abortion of human rights, and rightly so. This abortion of our human rights, denying the very right of an individual to be an individual. This is now and has always been the struggle of the African American. It has always been the struggle to assert his individuality, to assert her individuality, as well as her human and his human existence. While other Americans were rejoicing in their freedom, the African slave could not. While other Americans were celebrating their liberty, the African slave could not. While other Americans were celebrating the revolution from the British Empire, the African slave knew nothing about independence. For us, there was no Boston Tea Party. We only had acres and acres of cotton fields to pick. For us, there was no Paul Revere, who was our midnight rider. We only had Harriet Tubman, who was our Moses on the Underground Railroad. For us, there was no marching battle bands that led us into battle against the British. We only had the old Negro spirituals that called our ancestors to the battle for freedom and for survival. We knew nothing about the battle hymn of the Republic in those days. We knew songs like Go Down Moses, Way Down in Egypt Land, and Tell O Pharaoh to Let My People Go. Songs like Didn't My Lord Deliver Daniel? And if my Lord delivered Daniel, then my Lord will deliver us. Songs like Steal Away, Steal Away, Steal Away to Jesus. I ain't got long to stay here. What our forefathers and foremothers needed was not just the first American Revolution, but we needed a second American Revolution. Not just a revolution that gave us freedom from the king over in Britain and in England. We needed a revolution that gave us freedom from the slave master and the plantation in Georgia and South Carolina and Virginia and Texas and Louisiana and Florida. We needed our own revolution, our own American Revolution, whereby we can sing our songs of freedom. This is what Dr. Martin Luther King was referring to when he said that America has a responsibility to make good on its promissory note. That there has been a promise given to its citizens that all of us are able to be free. And Dr. King said that check that was given to us by our country has been marked with insufficient funds. It has come up short, and the civil rights movement was birthed out of that passion and desire to make the American Revolution a revolution for all Americans and not just some Americans. It was the enforcement of our own freedom. It came with blood, sweat, and tears. It came with pain and struggle and agony. James Weldon Johnson beautifully put pen to paper and captured our ancestral journey with these words when he said, "We have come over a way that with tears have been watered. We have come treading a path through the blood of the slaughtered." You cannot responsibly deny that our individual and social condition as a race of people today is directly related to our collective experience as a race of people from our past. We are where we are now in our thought life, in our natural life, in our mentality, because of what we experience together as a group of people and as a group of individuals. The condition of any people can always be related directly to their common heritage and their common experiences. The historical experiences of any people will always leave a psychological imprint on them. And that psychological imprint that has been left on us, on African Americans, is easily seen in our modern and common culture today. We no longer have chains that hold our arms and shackle our legs down. We no longer have whips and stripes that beat our back. We are able to sit anywhere we want on public buses. We can go to any school we'd like to go to. We live in an integrated society. We're not slaves in the natural sense, but so many of us are still plagued with psychological enslavement. Many of us are still slaves psychologically. Many of us are still struggling with this ability or this inability, I should say, to rise and lift ourselves to a place of personal and human self-dignity. Many of us are still struggling because the chains have moved from our shackles on our hands and feet, and those chains have gotten on our minds and in our brains. And this is why we struggle in our modern day society to have the normal moral conscience, to have the normal human dignity. Things as simple as pulling up your pants and wearing them right. Things as simple as getting a job and going to work. Things as simple as if you father a child, you ought to be in the home to raise the child that you fathered. We are still in a day where we're struggling with psychological slavery. Too many of us have been left behind. There is still too many of us who suffer from the effects of the slavery of our past. The reality that is called psychological slavery is this: it is the mental condition of any oppressed people, whereas they react and respond to life from the unconscious perspective of being inferior or less than their oppressors. It is the mental condition that causes an individual to react to life from the unconscious belief that he is less than his oppressors. It is to forever see the oppressor as an oppressor and never see themselves as an overcomer or a liberator. The effects of this kind of thinking causes for psychologically enslaved people to live a categorically lower quality of life due to a lack of personal and social self-dignity. The evidence of this kind of slavery is all around us. It is in every high crime statistic. The evidence of psychological slavery is all around us. It is in the high incarceration rates of African American men and women. It is even noticed in our family structures, as well as in our school classrooms. It is the primary reason for the ghetto mentality that is not only pervasive in our culture, but very popular in our culture. It is this twisted mentality that I wonder what Dr. King would say about if he were here. To listen to the music and the lyrics that we promote across our airwaves and radio waves, that categorically denigrate and malign our women as well as our children by calling them names that used to be offensive, that used to be hurtful and insulting to us. We now use it as a term of endearment. It is a psychological enslavement when you have pride and take honor and dignity in selling drugs to your own community. It's a psychological enslavement when the N-word can't be used anywhere else unless a black man is talking to another black man. It says we have somehow diminished and diluted our own perspective of our human dignity. We have accepted our role of inferiority. And now I call you the N-word as a term of love and respect, not knowing where the word comes from and what the word means, having this denial of the beauty of my Afrocentrism, the beauty of my blackness, denying it by lowering it through a word that others have used to hurt me, to lynch me, to destroy me, to kill me, to damage me. But now I celebrate the word. It is because we are slaves psychologically. When a man does that, he's a psychological slave. I don't need to tell you about Mary McLeod Bethune. I don't need to tell you about Sojourner Truth. I don't need to tell you anything about Harriet Tubman. I don't need to talk about Merle Evers. I ain't got to talk about Mama Till. You ought to know those names. You ought to know who those people are. Not one of them, not one of them, our foremothers, would have ever allowed some kid to write a rap song and call them a B.I. Not one of them. We have lost a lot. When our young girls are so lost in their identity that we listen and love songs that call us by names that have objectified our women and made our women property and not people. When you objectify a woman and make her a property and not a person, you are acting in the same spirit of the slave mentality. Do you know what made the slave so fearful? He was fearful because when one was lynched, he was put on a tree and hung so everybody else could see. And the idea was what happened to him is going to happen to you if you step out of line. Whenever you call someone out their name or you denigrate them verbally, you are lynching their self-esteem and lynching their personal dignity and lynching their sense of moral conscience. And when that happens, you're left with somebody who is property and not a person. And when you are property and not a person, we have rolled the time machine back. We've gone back to 1700s and become slaves all over again. But this time, we cannot say what we said last time. Last time we could blame somebody else. Last time we could point the finger at somebody else. Last time we talked about the transatlantic slave trade and how it damaged us, but you can't blame them this time. This time it's up to us to change our own psychological condition. It's up to us to better ourselves, lift ourselves, strengthen. Is anybody hearing me? It's up to us this time. It's up to us this time. If you don't have an education as a black man or a black woman, it's up to you this time. If you don't have gainful employment and a solid career as a black man or a black woman, it's up to you this time. If you don't have a healthy, happy home life where you understand you're a man and a father or a mother and a woman, and you have, it's up to you this time. It's up to you to stay in school. It's up to you to better yourself. It's up to you to kick the drug habit. It's up to you to stop selling drugs on our street corners. And it's up to you to come out of the gangs. It's up to us this time. We can't blame everybody else like we've done in the past. Dr. King would have us look in the mirror. Dr. King spoke about a world where opportunity would be universal. Now that opportunity is universal, we've got to make the conscious decision to take a hold of what has been provided for us. Is anybody hearing what I'm saying? Now, I know what you're saying. You're saying, but Pastor, you're forgetting about those who have taken advantage of the opportunity. Those who have stood up to say, I'll not blame no one this time. Those who have said, I'm responsible for my own outcome and condition. And we have made it well. Yes, we have. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Oh, yes, we have. We are congressmen. We are state senators. We have been U.S. senator. We are local leaders. We are CEOs, commissioners, elected officials, preachers and pastors. We are doctors and lawyers. We are physicists and chemists. We are astronauts. We have made it. We have done well. But there's something we have forgotten. Out of all of our success, we forgot to stop long enough on the road to our destiny and take a detour for just a short while and find our brother who is over in the corner and have not made it like we have made it. And stop, walk over, pick him up, and carry him on the same road that we're on. We forgot about those who were left behind. Are you listening to me? We've got degrees on our wall, alphabets in front of and behind our name. And we've forgotten about our social and moral responsibility. Are you understanding what I'm saying? You see, the whole thing that made the civil rights movement work, it was not that Dr. King or Ralph David Abernathy or C.T. Vivian or the other heroes of the civil rights movement that they started from scratch. They did not start from scratch. The civil rights movement of the 1960s, it began in the 1890s. It began whenever there was one named Plessy. Plessy decided he was going to board a train as a black man. He got on a train in Louisiana that was barred for him to ride as a black man in the car of a white train. And Plessy said, my money spends like everybody else. And in 1890, Plessy got on that train going to Louisiana. He was arrested and went to jail for violating the segregation law. And Plessy stood up and said, I have a right to ride any train I desire to ride. He lost the case on the local level. He lost the case at the state level. And Plessy versus Ferguson went to the Supreme Court, and he lost at the Supreme Court level. The law of the land was so that blacks would stay in their place and whites would stay in their place. We're talking 1896. Funny how Plessy got on a train, sat in the wrong part of the train, and was arrested. Rosa Parks got on a bus, sat on the wrong part of the bus, and was arrested. Dr. King formed a march in Alabama against that oppression. Is anybody getting what I'm saying? It is because Plessy versus Ferguson was done. It gave the power to one attorney named Thurgood Marshall. That Thurgood Marshall would do in reverse what Plessy versus Ferguson had established about 60 years before. He stood up and he said that this is not right, that schools are being segregated. And Brown versus Board of Education, it reversed what Plessy versus Ferguson had established. It's not because Thurgood Marshall started from scratch. He was standing on the shoulders of somebody else who had already gone before him. Here's what I want to say to us this morning. You're standing on somebody's shoulder. Stand well. You're standing on somebody's shoulder. Hold your head up high. Stick out your chest. Straighten up your back and be what God's called you to be, because you have a responsibility. You have a responsibility. You never make it by yourself. You never will survive if you are still alone. We have got to find a way to advance the social and mental consciousness of our people. We've got to find a way. We cannot rely nor depend on anybody else to pull us up out of this psychological slavery. We can't rely on anybody else to pull us up out. We've got to have the fortitude to do it ourselves. Are you hearing what I'm saying? We have got to be able to re-educate ourselves. in the book, The Miseducation of the Negro, it spoke not so much about what the Negro knew, but it spoke about what the Negro didn't know. Because what the Negro doesn't know is what's killing him. When we go to school, we are not taught, we're not educated in who we are. Our social identity is not, our self-identity is not given to us when we sit in our school systems. When I went to school, I learned a whole lot about King Louis the 14th. I went to school and I learned a whole lot about King George. I went to school and I learned a whole lot about Queens of England. I learned a whole lot about the czars of Russia. I learned a whole lot about the emperors of China. But when I was in school and I opened the history books, page after page after page, nobody on them books looked like me. It made me think that I did not have a unique contribution to this world. Because my contribution was not recorded in the history books. Is anybody hearing what I'm saying? When I go down to the capitals of any capital in the South, not just the one here in Georgia, but any capital in the South, when I look at the state buildings of any capital in the South, and I see the fine murals and big pictures hanging on the wall, I don't see any pictures, but maybe a few here and there that look like me. It makes me think that I didn't have any contribution to the state as a whole. Whenever I go down to Washington, D.C., thank God it don't happen no more. When I used to go down to Washington, D.C. and look at all of the statues up in the Washington Mall, I was bothered because none of those statues and busts looked like me. Because you lose your sense of identity if you're not educated in who you are. They forgot, it was not intentional, they just forgot to tell us about King Pompey or King Sir Hugh the First or Queen Nefertiti. They forgot to tell us anything about King Hannibal the Great, who marched his army from the eastern shores of Asia all the way down to North Africa. They forgot to tell us about who we were in Zulu tradition and who we were in Zambia tradition and who we are as kings and queens in our country, in our motherland. They forgot to tell us about that, but we've got to make sure that we tell ourselves about it. We've got to make sure we stand up and say it loudly and proudly. My history did not begin in 1611. My history did not begin whenever this country was founded and when the shores were stepped on by the Mayflower. My history does not begin as a slave. My history does not begin whipped and beat in master's corners. My history begins a long ways away from here. People who knew how to survive and thrive and to make it on little of nothing. That is our history, and we have to be educated about who we are. But we've gotten so comfortable and caught and stuck in all of our alphabets and letters at the end of our name. We've got so many alphabets, it's funny, that we have lost some awareness of our individual identity as a people. And so I close with this notion and thought of how we have to live if we're going to survive. If we're going to survive, we have to live by that African story that's told about folks sitting around a banquet table. In one village and in another village, they're sitting around another banquet table. But in the village A, their arms are strapped down to their waist, and their legs are shackled, and they can't reach up to their mouths. There's a bowl of porridge in front of them, and they can barely reach it with the arms that they have and the spoon on the end of it. And no matter how much they try, they can't get the porridge up to their mouths because they are shackled, restricted, and denied the right to eat. He said, but in the other village, same scenario. They're shackled around their waist, arms and hands locked, feet locked, sitting at a banquet table, and bowls of porridge are all in front of them. And they've given the same spoon that they have. They reach over and dip the spoon in the porridge. And the story says that one group was fat and flourishing. The other group was starving and emaciated. And the question was asked, what's the difference? They said one group took the spoon, dipped it in the porridge, couldn't get it to his own mouth. So he leaned over and fed his neighbor. And when he fed the man sitting beside him, the one on his other side fed him. So he was able to eat and feed somebody else. And as long as they were feeding each other, everybody got a chance to eat. Can I get a witness here? If we're going to survive and thrive, we've got to learn how to feed each other. We've got to learn how to educate each other. We've got to learn how to help each other. We've got to learn how to support each other. Because if we don't support each other, the day will come when we will be emaciated and lost, hungry and confused. I'm standing here today because somebody had enough faith to feed me. I'm standing here not because of my own ability to feed myself, but somebody loved me enough to reach down and feed me. It was a mother, a grandmother. It was a friend, a coach, or a teacher that loved me enough to feed me, a pastor or a preacher that loved me enough to feed me. You're standing where you're standing today because somebody loved you enough to feed you. Dr. King's dream is that we would rise from the depths of our own mental oppression and realize the beauty of what freedom really symbolizes. It's Langston Hughes that said, hold on to dreams, for if dreams die, they're like a broken winged bird that cannot fly. He said, hold on to dreams, for if dreams go, they become a frozen field covered with snow. Don't let the dream die. Don't let the dream die in our miseducation, misinformation, and psychological slavery. But let the dream live so we can move from civil rights to human rights. Thank you so much.
Let's give another round of applause for our speaker for the hour, Pastor Marlon Harris, for those inspiring words. Right before the choir come up, I have some closing remarks. We'll bring up the chaplain and pray us out, and then they'll sing us out of here, okay? So it is truly, truly an honor. So many people have contributed to this planning meeting. But before we begin to acknowledge those people who have worked so diligently, you know, Dr. King, before his death, he took a trip. He took a trip to Memphis. And why did he go to Memphis? To speak for those workers who had not had a voice, who had been oppressed, who had not been dealt with fairly, those sanitation workers in the city of Memphis. And so we can't forget why he was doing what he was doing. He was talking about civil rights and leading over to human rights and making sure that everybody had the dignity to work and be compensated fairly for the work that they do. And they had those protections. And so he fought for our people that were working, that were picking up our garbage, picking up our waste, the stuff that we were throwing out. If we have any sanitation workers here in DeKalb County that is here today, we want you to stand. We want to acknowledge you. Anybody in the sanitation department that is in here? All right. Give most of them applause in their absence. And all DeKalb County workers, let me tell you something. We have, you know, over 6,000 employees that work for our great county. 6,000. Y'all heard that our budget is over $1 billion. 60 to 70% of our budget is just people. It's paying for the people who deliver the services to us each and every day. And we can't be the county that we are called to be. And you can't have services delivered to you if it were not the people that are employed here in DeKalb County to deliver those services. If you work for DeKalb County, just go ahead and wave your hand. Just go ahead and wave your hand. Let me tell you, let me just say this. Thank you from the bottom of our heart for the work that you do for our county, for what you mean to us. Let me tell you this. The work that you do on behalf of DeKalb County, there is no way that we can compensate you for what you mean to DeKalb County. Now, I hear what you're saying. Please try. Please try. And let me say, we are. Okay, we are looking. Y'all have seen stuff in the news. Y'all have seen our police and fire on the news saying we need more pay. And guess what? You are right. And y'all have my commitment that we are going to, in a very substantive way, make some adjustments to your compensation this year. Now, it costs money. Let's be clear. It costs money. But we have to make sure that we are doing what Dr. King was fighting for back those years ago, fighting for the protections and the workers who deliver services to our people. So I'm so thankful for you all and what you mean to DeKalb County. Let me acknowledge our planning committee member, Sheila O'Rear, program chair. Sheila, where are you? There she is, Sheila. Thank you. thank you so much, Sheila. She won't let me sing, y'all. She's keeping me down. She's oppressing me. Lakeisha Avery Carter, DeKalb County Choir Chairperson, thank you. Didn't she sing beautiful earlier, you all? She did. Nicole Sims from my office, she was panicking, y'all. And all those memos that the pastor was sending out, they went directly to her. And I said, we got to bring in Pastor Marlon Harris. Anastasia Martin, Diamond Lewis, Burke Brennan. I call him our hype man. Y'all know Burke is our hype man. He gets us hype. Thank you, Burke. Aretha Relaford from my office. And Tyrone, our sound man. Thank you, Tyrone, as always, for who you are and what you mean to DeKalb County. Portia, thank you, as always, for being our spokesperson for DeKalb County. We got a new title for her. She's our marketing director. Pastor Harris, again, thank you for what you mean. Thank you for that powerful, powerful, powerful word. Thank you for the work that you're doing with New Life and what you mean for Decatur and DeKalb County as well. Lou Walker Ambassadors, those people who brought you all in. We love Lou Walker. They love us. Our young saints work hard for us. Thank you. Our interpretive dancer, Starla Martin. Starla, thank you for that dance. Wasn't she beautiful, you all, in dancing? Maude Baker Flower Shop, Riverdale Florals, Mobile Expressions. We want to thank you for the flowers, for the balloons, for those expressions as well. Our police department, you saw our honor guard coming in. Those people who told us to carry on. Thank you for you, DCTV, as always, for what you do, our Parks and Rec Department, and all DeKalb County employees, our music director and keyboard, Reginald Carter, our choir directors, Ms. Benton, that's Pastor Benton's. That's Pastor Benton's daughter. I thought there was. I don't know where she is. She gone. She had to leave. The drummer, Andrew Malone, and bass, Michael Norwood, and all those in the band as well. We want to thank you so, so much for what you are. All elected officials, thank you for being present. Choir, let's go ahead. Before we go out of here, we're going to have our benediction, and we're going to sing you all up out of here. So we're going to have the choir, and then we're going to have, well, exactly, it says a benediction here. Then we're going to have the closing song. So let's go ahead and have the benediction by Chaplain Sandy Purnell. Is that who's doing it?
Yes.
Okay. And then we're going to sing you all up out of here, okay?
Let the church say amen. Amen. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
We just thank God for everybody up here. I'm cutting it short because I know everybody's tired. But anyway, we thank you, Pastor,
And he did a favor for me years ago with his Black College Workshop. You remember, you were probably too young to remember, but you did it. But anyway, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray, seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sins and hear their land. 2 Chronicles 7:14. So we thank God for the pastor today. We thank God for our lecture officials and thank God for you, Ms. Posher, and everything. And thank you all for coming out in the rain. God bless all of you. Amen.